Today, I would like to introduce everyone to the CFD software developed by a company named Cradle, and later it got acquired by MSC Corporation in 2016. So let us start with today's webinar content, where we will be going through what is CFD and the complete procedure, how to get a post-process video after completing each and every important step which is required in CFD, and what are the job opportunities currently available for freshers with experience. As many of us know that what CFD is, but I would like to make it a little simple so that it becomes easier to understand. Everybody thinks CFD is a very complex and difficult subject. So actually CFD means it is a branch of fluid mechanics that uses the numerical techniques as well as the data structures to analyze the problem that involved the fluid flow. The major three equations which we usually use in CFD are continuity equation, momentum equation, and energy equation. Now, why CFD is required and why are we using CFD? The reason is, with the current scenario, the increasing complexity in the design, and to achieve the better performance of a product which are related to a flow, are need to be solved using CFD technique, as analytical approaches are very difficult. There are three points which we need to understand. One is, it helps us to predict the performance of a design. It gives us the insights about the performance. If a particular parameter is changed, how the overall performance of the product is changing. It is also a cost effective as well as time saving. There are three different approaches which we currently use in industry to predict the flow. One is the theoretical approach, another one is the experimental approach, and third one is the CFD, which is very new. Theoretical approach is something which is related to equations and we solve it in our books. It is limited to only few limited number of problems because of the assumptions we consider during performing the calculations. Experiment approach is very expensive and sometimes difficult to set up. One of the example, if we consider wind tunnel experiments where aerofoil is analyzed and car is analyzed. So the aerofoil analysis is very easy and easy to set up. But when you set up a car scenario, 1:1 scale, it is very difficult as many things has to be considered. In CFD approach, we can scale up and scale down the model. That is a combination of both theoretical and experimental. Theoretical, it is because we use our equations, we code the CFD equations. An experimental approach, because we are able to visualize by changing one particular parameter how the entire flow changes. It also requires a very good computer resource to solve complex problems. So nowadays CFD is in a boom in the market. Now, different domains of CFD which we can see around us are aerospace domain, automotive domain, chemical and life science domain, electronics, architectural, machinery, ship, and multi-phase domains. Majority people use CFD for pumps to analyze the performance of the propeller and the blades. Going through the design cycle, how a CFD model is built. First, we have some design from any CAD software. Then we take that CAD software, we clean that CAD software with respect to CFD. That is called as geometry cleanup. Now we have a CFD CAD. From that CAD, we make sure that the design what we are expecting with respect to CFD is met. Then we build a mesh on that. From that mesh is nothing but representation of the CFD CAD. On that particular mesh, we apply the boundary conditions as well as equations, the governing equations as well as the turbulence models. That is called a CFD model. When we put this CFD model for solution, in solver, we get the solution parameters, like what would be the change, what is the velocity, what is the pressure. We get those type of parameters. Then we go to the post-processing. In post processing, we visualize that the velocity or the pressure which we are expecting is met by the particular design or not. If it is not met in the design requirement, we go to the optimization and we again try to change the design, the overall design, so that we get the design requirement. So this is the basic CFD cycle which each and everyone should know. This is one of the example like geometry cleanup. What do we mean by geometry cleanup? In this page, we are seeing there is some electronic chip with some leads, silicon leads are there. In CFD, if you go and model this particular chip, the silicon leads are very thin, very small. And to mesh it, we require large number of elements. So to overcome this, we neglect the silicon leads. We apply the total heat content of that particular area to the complete chip itself. Black 11, which is in the middle. So this is the way of assumption which we are implying in the CFD software. Now, different governing equations usually we follow. This is the continuity equation, this is the momentum equation, and this is the energy equation, the third one. This comes from the basic fluid mechanics, where we tell that mass is conserved, momentum is conserved, and it follows the energy equation, the temperature is also conserved. So these equations are very basics which everybody need to know and need to understand how these equations are derived, so that when we do any problem related to mass conservation of mass, only mass, then we are able to judge that the values which we have received are right or wrong. Now, very important things we need to know before starting a CFD simulation or before you becoming a CFD expert. These are the questions first we need to ask ourselves. What kind of fluid we are using? Is it a gas or is it a liquid? If it is a gas, what type of gas? What are its material property? What is the specific heat what we can expect? What are the different parameters what a gas has? The viscosity, dynamic viscosity. If it's a liquid water, what would be its water's viscosity? How is the specific heat changing for a particular liquid? So these questions, if we have answers for these questions, we have a particular known that, okay, it's an air flow, we'll be using air, or it's a water flow, we'll be using water with these many parameters. Coming to the second point, what type of flow we are going to analyze? Is it going to be a laminar flow or it's going to be a turbulent flow? To answer this question, we need to understand the concept of Reynolds number. Reynolds number is a, Reynolds was a scientist who discovered that for particular Reynolds number, the flow becomes laminar or the flow becomes turbulent. So we need to have understanding of this particular terms. Then now coming to CFD, after understanding the material properties and the type of flow, we need to understand what should be the domain size. Domain is nothing but, for example, if you consider an aircraft flying in an air, and if you create a domain close to its very vicinity, then the effects, the wall effects, which we call it in CFD, the shear effects or the friction effects from the wall, it's going to affect the overall value of the aircraft CL and CD, if we are determining the CL and CD of an aircraft. So we need to understand and define a domain such that the walls of the domain do not interact with the flow close to the body. Now, what are the assumptions and conditions I brought? Are we only going to look at the flow type, or we are also including our heat or the temperature? If somebody is emitting some temperature, for example, some cockpit chip is emitting some temperature, then how it is affecting the flow, how the flow near that chip is, or how the cooling of that chip is happening? What type of conditions need to be applied so the chip parameter is completely developed in the CFD? So we need to understand the assumptions, the conditions involved. Then comes, how do we want to the flow to be calculated? Are we looking for something called a steady state or transient state? To understand what steady and transient state is, assume you are traveling from location A is your starting point and you are reaching a location B, that is your destination. You are starting directly from A and going to B, but that is called a transient state. But if you go from A to C, C to D, then D to B, that is called a transient state, because you are calculating the time, you are varying along the time, you are not looking ultimately you are reaching B. Both the participants at A are going to reach B, but the direct path from A to B is called as a steady state, and from transient state from A to D, A to C, then from C to B. So the path which is taken by a flow is called as transient state. The more it will be understood in the coming slides. Then which type of turbulent model or equations we need to adapt while solving the CFD? So like there are one equation model, two equation models, Pallotta-Murras, K omega, K epsilon, SST. There are many different models which we need to understand their importance and which model will suit a particular application. For example, Pallotta-Murras model was developed basically for aerospace industry. But with the coming time and scenario and the complexity in the flow, SST K omega model is very useful because it SST K omega involves both K epsilon and K omega, and SST K omega act as a blending between SST K epsilon and K omega. So we need to understand difference between these models so that we can set up a proper CFD simulation. So going with the material properties, we need to understand a few basic parameters of a material. Like if we are talking about density, if it's a liquid, what would be the density? If it's a air, how the density would vary? For example, this property helps us to determine how the intermolecular forces are acting. So in gas, the molecules are far away, so it has low density. If you assume a box of 1x1 area, I'm looking in two dimension. If you assume and if you have elements in that, you will find that the gas molecules are far apart from each other. But if you consider a liquid in a box, it will have the molecules are close to each other. So the density of gas varies and the density of water varies differently. So if you assume it to be a air, density is actually directly proportional to temperature and pressure. As pressure increases, when temperature is constant, density decreases. Conversely, when temperature increases, pressure is constant and density decreases. So it's nothing but gas equation. PV is equal to nRT. So if we try to assume that P is equal to N by V into RT, we'll get P is equal to rho RT. So density for a constant temperature, density increases if pressure decreases. So from there, that is the basic principle or basic understanding of the equation which is used in our CFD problem setting. Now understanding what type of flow, is it a compressible flow or incompressible flow? Usually in wind tunnel experiments as well as in aerodynamics, any flow below 0.3 Mach is considered to be incompressible flow, and any flow above 0.3 is considered to be compressible flow. So if you convert the 0.3 for air, 0.3 Mach of 340 meters per second, you get around something 100 meters per second. So any velocity below 100 meters per second is considered to be incompressible flow, and anything above 340, above 100 meters per second is considered to be compressible flow. Now understanding the viscosity effect, because air is less viscous when compared to water. So the viscosity is nothing but a measure of resistance to the deformation at a given rate. For example, you can see in the image on the right hand side where you can see oil is being poured out of a beaker as well as water. Instead of oil, you can assume it to be a ketchup, tomato sauce ketchup, which is also a thick when compared to water. So it shows the friction between one layer to another layer. So viscosity also plays a major role when CFD comes into picture. Now specific heat, when you are analyzing any heat related or temperature related problems, you need to understand what is the specific heat of that particular liquid. For example, it is a measure of energy that you need to supply to change the temperature of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. Okay, so it is a very important parameter when we need to understand how the flow changes with respect to temperature. Now, what type of flow it is? Is it a laminar flow or a turbulent flow? If you have ever observed in nature and if you have burnt any incandescent candles, you can see the flow close to the incense sticks, you can find the flow to be laminar because the velocity is very less. But as the flow starts to rise due to the surrounding air, the turbulent flow is visualized. So to differentiate between the type of flow, this is one of the simplest experiment which we can try and visualize difference between the laminar flow as well as the turbulent flow. This is the example which I was talking about to understand the computational domain. If a domain is drawn something like this, okay, and there is some inlet over here, then the values what we are going to get is not right, because the boundary is interacting with the geometry itself, which is not right. So in that case, we need to have a finite space, something like this, where the walls of the domain which you are going to create around the body like this aircraft should not interact with the body itself, so that the flow is not disturbed at the location. So this is very important to understand, like, what should be the domain. Now going to understand what is the mesh. What do we usually mean by mesh? Mesh is nothing but the practice of dividing a big geometric space into discrete elements or geometric topologies cells. Like, assume you have a box. In how many elements can you divide the box? Assume you have to divide it in 1 cross. There is a box of 1 cross 1 cross 1. You divide it into 8 elements. So we'll have a cube placed in such a format that 1 cross 1 is being completely covered. That is called as discretization. Usually the methods which we use to define the mesh or construct the mesh are hexahedral mesh. That is called a structured mesh. Tetrahedral mesh, which is called as unstructured mesh, and with the recent developments, every software is coming up with the polyhedral mesh. There are few advantages of using this polyhedral mesh. So this is the representation of the structured mesh. The first one, that is called as hexahedral mesh. The second one is the polyhedral mesh, and third one is the tetrahedral mesh. The advantage of this polyhedral mesh is calculates more faster, it requires less number of elements, and it has larger surface area when compared to the other two elements. So with the coming scenario and in terms of accuracy, polyhedral mesh is a new elements which has been developed by the CFD tools. When you come to the wall conditions, now are we considering the friction? Now the air is having a friction. We know that it has some viscosity. But are we considering those viscous effect on the body is our question. So usually we use two terms, no slip and free slip. No slip is a condition where at the surface of the wall, close to, very adjacent to the wall, the flow is happening, and that the velocity is considered to be zero. As shown in no slip condition, the velocity is considered to be zero, and the tangential velocity is nothing but the free stream velocity. So you get the shear layer. Now in free slip condition, we neglect the friction forces and we tell that at the wall also, the flow is the free stream velocity, of the free stream velocity. To understand the transient and steady simulation, I have an example over here. Assume you have a beaker as shown in this image, a tap is open and you have a tap from which the beaker's outlet is happening. Consider a situation where the inlet flow is equal to outlet flow. That is, the poured water is equal to the discharge water, where the water level in the beaker always remains the same. It is a constant. So this type of simulation is called the steady state, that there where the variation between the parameters are not observed and it reaches to an equilibrium position. Now when you assume the transient simulation, you figure out in this image that the outlet from the beaker is more when compared to the poured water. So what happens over a period of time, the water in the beaker starts reducing and it reaches to some level. So for example, if I want to consider in 1 second, what is the discharge rate or how much water has been reduced in the beaker? After 2 seconds, how much water has been reduced in the beaker? So if we are looking the change of any parameter with respect to time, we call it to be a transient simulation. That means the data is varying along the time. The flow features or the flow parameters are varying along the time is called as transient. And the solution is equilibrium and it is not varying like in the first example, then it is said to be a steady state simulation. Now, in this software, the advantage is very good in terms of post-processing. We can observe in this particular page that how a mesh can be displayed along with contours and streamlines can be displayed. We can determine what is the flow of heat from one part to another. If assume I have a bulb or any electronic chip, I need to determine what is the transfer of heat energy from one source to another. We do not need to do any hand calculation or anything, because once you have enabled the heat option in this MSC Cradle software, you get a chart like this where you just need to go and access this chart. So coming back to this mesh, mesh is nothing but we are dividing a complete computational domains in small elements where the calculations can be applied. So there are three different types of mesh which we are currently using in the industry. That is the hexahedral mesh, the tetrahedral mesh, as well as the polyhedral mesh. Basic visualization of hexahedral mesh is on the left hand side, which is nothing but a structured format, a cube format. The tetrahedral mesh is nothing but the triangular format or the pyramid format, which is on the right, the extreme right. And the new one is the polyhedral mesh. The advantage of polyhedral mesh is it's faster, it has more surface area to capture, and it gives more accurate results when compared to other two. And it is the robust and new technology which has been developed using the polyhedral mesh. These polyhedral mesh are formed using the polygons, and around where the tetrahedral mesh, the corners and the nodes are merged to form a complete honeycomb structure like polygon. So the polyhedral mesh is very useful in accuracy as well as in terms of speed.